So, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to start the meeting. So, if you do plan on speaking tonight, we just kindly ask. There's a sign-in sheet over there. This is going to be taped live as well. So again, if you could put your cell phones on vibrate and just shut off the volume, we would truly appreciate that. For purposes, if anybody has to use the restrooms, they're through that door back to the left. And again, we will now call the meeting to order. I'm joined by my three colleagues, Councillor-At-Large Shayna Barnes, Councillor-At-Large Moises Rodriguez, and Councillor-At-Large Winthrop Farwell, and I'm Bob Sullivan, Councillor-At-Large. First of all, before we start the actual meeting, I just wanted to explain the reason for these meetings, the basis of these meetings. A few months ago, we held our first citywide Councillor-At-Large meeting at North Middle School. It was very well attended. And myself and my three colleagues, we made a pledge this year that was long overdue that we do attend all the ward meetings, but you know what? We serve the entire city, all 28 precincts, all 7 wards, and it would be appropriate to do this. So what we thought from a strategy standpoint is we would do the 4 meetings around the city at the different middle schools. So this, again, is the second one. With that being said, I'm going to call the meeting to order. If we could please stand and salute the flag. The flag's over there on the wall to the right. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you very much. Really what we learned from the first meeting is this is for you. We serve you, the constituents, the taxpayers, the residents, business owners in the city of Brockton. So we do have an agenda. There's plenty of copies on that front table. Help yourself to water and some Dunkin' Donuts donuts. But at the end of the day, again, we're gonna discuss some things. All 4 of us will pass the mics, and then when we get to the Q&A session, which we're going to probably do relatively soon, again, if you do choose to speak and ask any questions, just kindly come to the microphone again because it is being recorded. And with that being said, I'm going to pass the mic. I'm going to start with Councillor Barnes, and if Shayna wants to give any updates or any words of wisdom or anything at all.
Thank you, Councillor.
Thank you. Thank you, Councillor Sullivan. I just first want to recognize also several other officials in the room. We have the city solicitor, Phil Nisrala, here. Thank you so much for coming. And we also have our Beamer Emergency Management coordinator here, Mr. Stephen Hook. Thank you so much for also coming. And we have cable here, access, and like Councillor Sullivan said, we are being recorded live today from the Spark and Emily Reynolds. And also coming in is Officer Healy, from the Policemen's Union and Neighborhood Watch Coordinator. So I thank you all for coming, and I want to also thank my colleagues for having the foresight to want to do this and to continue it and to keep it going. We're small in numbers today, but I'm pretty sure that we all, you know, can contribute in a great way. So I'm just happy to be here. I'm not going to say too much, and because, you know, this is for you. Like Councillor Sullivan said, this is for you to share your information or ask any questions or get clarification on things. The last time, I think we got a lot done. We were able to dialogue and to definitely get some things clarified going forward to get us here to this point. So if we just continue in that collaborative, cooperative action and relationship, I think we'll be okay. So we'll speak again later.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Farwell.
Thank you very much, Councillor Sullivan. Thank you, Councillor Barnes. I think one of the other reasons we wanted to do this is there's nothing worse than being an elected official and you only see them at campaign time. And we want to stay with you. We want to be connected with you. And we can't be everywhere, so we really depend upon people to give us feedback, give us criticism, give us suggestions. Our big challenge will be coming up shortly when we receive the budget book for fiscal year 2017. I understand that's coming out late next week. That will be a huge document for all of us to go through page by page. The other thing that pleases me is we've worked very cooperatively with each other and also with our fellow councillors. We've passed an urban renewal plan for downtown, and we really do a lot of collaboration. We do a lot of discussion because nothing gets done unless you have a team. Doesn't mean we always agree. We sometimes come at things from different viewpoints, but I think it's been a very productive 4 months since we've been in office. It's been my pleasure to serve with my colleagues, and again, we welcome you here tonight, and we always want to hear from you because, as Councillor Sullivan said, You're it. I mean, that's why we run for office, because we find enjoyment in representing people and trying to do the best for the city.
Thank you, Councilor.
And now to Councilor Rodriguez.
Thank you, my fellow councilors. It's a pleasure being here. And I think I want to echo what has already been said by my colleagues here to my left, but the most important thing is that this is a non-election year, and we are conducting this listening tour. Often you've got elected officials coming down to the community and basically kind of preaching their will on you, and I think we'll try to do this a little different. We want to hear from the taxpayers, we want to hear from the residents, because there is no one that's more of an expert in your lives than you. I can sit here and tell you what goes on in my own life, but I can't really tell what's going on in your own life. So it's important for us to listen to what's going on in the minds of the voters and the taxpayers in this community, so that we can act appropriately. There's a lot of issues that we're going to be facing in this community, but we need to kind of work together as a unit, residents and city officials and elected officials, together to make this city a better city. We know what happens in times of the shortfalls in the budgets that we're going to be facing, and there's no way we're going to be able to do this without everybody kind of collaborating and working together to make this happen. So I along with my fellow councilors here, we're here just to listen to what you have, bring up some concerns, bring up some ideas and some thoughts of some things we can do a little bit better in city government to help you and help us make Brockton a better city.
I also do want to recognize Shane O'Brien, who's here tonight from the planning department. Thank you, Shane, for being here as well. And I do think that people will be trickling in. I know the Ward 3 Councillor Dennis Ianeri, this is Dennis's ward. He is joining us. He doesn't get out of work until, I believe, 7 o'clock, but he will be here. And I think really at the end of the day, we're going to invite anybody that works for the city. Hopefully someone from the school department will come as well. I know Superintendent Smith was here at the last meeting. It was very informative. But if Mr. Hook or Attorney Nazarella or Mr. Healy, Officer Healy, wants to come up, when Officer Healy comes up, again, he has to be very, very cautious of what he can disclose relative to active cases. But I think the feedback that the four of us got at the last meeting, is they really, really appreciate Officer Healy and his insight and trying to curb some of the issues in the city of Brockton. With that being said, maybe it's an opportune time now, Bill, if you don't mind, to have you come up from a public safety update. Again, Officer William Healy.
Okay.
Good evening, everybody. Bill Healy, Brockton Police Department, for those of you that don't know me. I'll keep it brief here. Like the councilor just said, last time they didn't have the TV here, so names and stuff I can't mention. I usually do, but we have to be careful on some of the things that I talk about, and I won't be long-winded about it. First and foremost, my contact information, especially for those that are watching, to start a crime watch, I'm going to make it simple. All you have to do is go online, Brockton Police Department, online. You'll see Neighborhood Watch. Click onto that. All my contact information is there. My email address, crimewatch@brocktonpolice.com. My office phone number, 508-897-5373. And we also have a tip line. You could either call the tip line number. I don't know because I don't read it. I don't call into it. 508-941-0244. You could call that line and leave a tip. A tip as in something's going on in your neighborhood that bothers you, common complaint, drug usage. Call that number, or what I prefer, if you use the computer, and most people do now, click onto the drop a dime, the link, and you could enter all of the information, very simple. Plate numbers if you can get them, names of people if you can get them, and I'll tell you, the years I've been doing it, it pays huge dividends. If you read the newspaper on a weekly basis, you can see every single week guns and or drugs from busts made, and a lot of those busts are made through anonymous tips that come through my office or go directly to the narcotics unit. The part of the drop a dime program is these tips that come into me, they're forwarded to the chief of police. The chief of police delegates the assignment, not just drugs, anything, abandoned motor vehicles, border health issues. He delegates the assignment, and it's followed up on. Again, very important that you submit these tips. It's like my campaign. I mentioned it at our last at-large back up on, at North Junior High. You know, there's that slogan, snitches get stitches. We're asking you, and we won't use the word snitching, we're asking you to help yourself, help your neighbors, help your family. You know who the bad guys are. Give us the tip. We'll do the rest of the work. The drop a dime program, one other very important thing. When you go on that, I'm sure the skeptics out there think, well, the police know who it is who are actually writing me. All I see is a number. You're basically a number when you write to me. I have no idea who you are. If you and I have a relationship like I do with the counselors, and they wanted to write me on my Crime Watch email address, hey, this is Bob, Shane, et cetera. And many people that know me throughout the city will do that because they have trust. But for those of you that don't know me or are skeptical of the police, and I get the concerns, sort of, I'll just buy into it like people are afraid of the police. I'll buy into it for whatever reason. Do that tip line. We'll never know where the tip's coming from. It's just impossible, and you have to have my trust on that. Just recently, I go to the enterprise and of course, records from the department. I have stacks like this, chronological order going back to, the past year. But most recently, not only is it tip stuff, but if you're in your house and you see suspicious activity, I get these calls all along, like, what am I going to do about this car, officer? If it's here like every single night, just call the police. And you wonder, should it be 911 or the non-emergency number, 941-0200? Just call 911. Just 2 weeks ago, a Brockton individual in Holbrook, he's in a playground in Holbrook, Brockton guy, bad guy, gun guy, in prison before, out of prison, in prison again, out of prison. Somebody called, suspicious vehicle, neighbor. Police come down, Holbrook PD, gotta give credit where credit is due, but he was a Brockton bad guy, out there for drug transaction. Guns and all sorts of drugs. This is back May 3rd, most recent. Just a phone call. Don't have to give your name. Recently, I just mentioned like every single week when we're making either a drug bust or a gun bust, just read the paper yourself. It's all public record. West Bridgewater, everybody here, heard about that chase from West Bridgewater into Brockton. Two guns, three bad guys arrested, all being held. It's these type of guys here that are caught, and they have been many the last couple of months, that I'm predicting, and I've been wrong before, I'm predicting a quieter summer. Because a lot of the key players have been captured. That being said, I said this at, where's Dennis Ianari? This counselor over there, Dennis Ianari is here from Ward 3. I said this at his ward meeting last June, and I was wrong, if he recalls. It was still kind of shoot him up there. But for the past couple of months, with all of these arrests, I'm making that prediction again. As you know, the state police, you see them out here driving around all the time. They're doing a lot of, not only are they involved in raids and stuff, working with our guys, FBI, you've heard it all before, but they're out there just doing simple things like pulling over cars. This particular one, they found a guy here with all of you be advised of this, expired inspection sticker. I have the right to pull you over. Pulled over the guy with the expired inspection sticker. No gun on this one, but heroin. Charged him with distribution. Expired sticker. So they're out there doing that. We're very aggressive, and the aggressiveness I hope has paid off or will pay off. And everybody here, and I'm not even going to go into it, everybody knows the big issue with the gun stuff and the crime stuff is all with has to do with the heroin stuff, which we all now know was epidemic across the country. President's involved with this stuff. It's so bad. So again, the easiest way to contact me, and by the way, to set up a watch group. For those of you that want to set up a watch, same thing. Go to the Brockton Police Department website, Neighborhood Watch, click down, contact me, and it's very simple to get a watch up and going. Just have Keith Ab Extension has a watch. Several of the neighborhoods behind us have a watch. Council Ionaries by Wilson on Wilson Street, they have a watch. Many, many watch groups in this area, as the councilor knows, and all you have to do is give me a call or email me, and we'll set that up. It's as simple as just getting your neighbors involved. And the neighbors take charge of that neighborhood. They invite me to present them with stats and hopefully solutions to any of the issues they have. What am I missing out on? Contact info. We're locking them up. Most importantly, we have the tip line. Very important, the tip line. Any questions? Counselor?
I just wanted to find out, what would somebody need to, is that the same tip line if they see graffiti, or is that a different line?
The easiest thing, if you see graffiti or something, I would go on to the City of Brockton website. I'd go on to that, or you could go to the Brockton Police Department website, because it all links up, and you click onto that if there's any graffiti issues, and Father Bills, I believe, is still handling that. You click onto that, they'll respond to take care of the graffiti. That's the easiest way to do it.
And can you also maybe just share with the audience here, with folks at home?
Could you share with us and the folks at home, since I guess there have been more councilor meetings, ward and at-large meetings, has there been an uptick in the neighborhood watch coordinating and things? Because I know the numbers were down for a while, but can you just maybe report on that and let people know what's going on?
So I can fudge the numbers all I want, but I'm not going to, because I'm all about honesty. That's what I, you know, seriously, right? Ex-police officer here. There's probably 100 plus active neighborhood watch groups. Here's the fudge part, which encompasses thousands of people, if that's the number you want to take. Why it's kind of like Pine Grove Drive, Chatham West, there's thousands of people that live there. Should I count them all? I will if you want. You know. So every month I meet with management at places like Pine Grove Drive to deal with issues, Chatham West, Walkover, Battles Farm. I have a meeting the end of June. So if 1,000 came, super. They know about the meeting. Like here, maybe more will trickle in. Should have 60, 70 people. It is what it is. So thousands of people reside in the neighborhoods where there's watch groups. But do I want to go on hand, you know, on record to say, I got tens of thousands of people coming to, it just isn't the case. And usually with my business and the business I'm in, it's always when something goes on, when something happens. On Moraine Street a couple of years ago, there was a bad guy living there. I've told this story before. I've been on this particular job now 28 years in Brockton PD. I've had the Crime Watch job for now 6 years. My first week, there were shots fired on Moraine Street. Nice street still. And they shot up a particular house, and it was due to a tenant whose son was a gangbanger. And it happened on two or three times a crime watch was formed. My phone ringing off the hook, all to be expected. Email groups, email contacts, regular meetings, really got involved. Could not get this guy in the family out of this house. And I went through all sorts of things trying to get him out until finally, actually never got him out. But what we did do is I sent the Board of Health down there because he was turning into an uncooperative landlord. He would not get rid of this bad guy that was creating a lot of problems for these people. And code enforcement went down there. There was a fire escape that was dislodged from the house. $20,000 project. But he had a good tenant, the mother. She was good. She worked hard. She paid her rent. Would not get rid of her. How did it end? The mother stayed. 4th of July. 5 years ago, he was gunned down on West Elm Street. He passed away. No issues on Moraine. Here's going back to what I just began to say. Haven't heard from anybody on Moraine Street. So neighborhood watch is a funny thing. I like it when people get together. I have one up by on the Avon line, the Mellon Street area, wooded. 55, 60 people showed up a few years ago. Councillor Cruz showed up to that one. I believe the councillor did. And would it be Councillor Cruz? No, wasn't him. Councillor McMillan at the time. So there were a whole bunch of huge turnout, and that was just kind of like people got together, pizza, etc., talked about the neighborhood, get to know each other. So that's the part I like about it too, and that's the way it should be. But again, issues on the street, crime watch is formed, issues go away, you don't hear from them again. I still consider them active. So that's my, how many people, how many groups we have. I'm long-winded tonight. Anybody? I bore myself. Anybody have any questions here? Police related? What's going on? Nothing. I'm going to be here the duration, so if you have something to say to me in the back room, you can. I'll be here. Thank you.
So Officer Healy, I mean, he's dedicated to his job. He cares. He does a great job, and he also lives in the city of Brockton. Yeah, he lives here in the city of Brockton. So please, yeah, I mean, please take him up on any of that. He really comes to all the ward meetings, and you know, when we mentioned this at a council meeting, he came right over to us and said, "When is it? I'm going to be there." Our good friend Ward, three Councilor Dennis Ianeri's here. Councilor, would you like to come up and give an update at all or anything? All right. And we also, thank you, Dennis. Absolutely, you can. We also are joined by Superintendent Kathy Smith. Thank you for being here. And in regards to public safety, I'm going to pass this on to Councilor Rodriguez, because there's an initiative that he spearheaded that's coming up, and it's really, it's a good thing for the city of Brockton. Councilor.
Well, thank you, Councilor Sullivan. We basically announced this the other day at the council meeting that we are putting together our the mayor says that it's a program that hasn't taken place in the last 20 years, but I know we've done this in the past. But in either case, we are putting together a gun buyback program here in the city of Brockton to try to work with citizens in this community to get rid of illegal guns in the streets of the city. We all know that guns are killing people, but guns by themselves aren't killing people. People are using guns to shoot up people, to terrify neighborhoods. Because it's not just the homicides that worries, residents and taxpayers. What worries a lot of us is the fact that you've got a lot of this random shooting in the community where God knows what happens when somebody just picks up a gun who's totally untrained and starts shooting up a neighborhood. An innocent person could actually get hurt. And then you're also damaging the properties that you're dealing with, because it's not just the bodily harms that sometimes are caused by gunfire, but the properties get all shot up, and those are a real issue. So we have come together as city government, leaving aside our differences, leaving aside the way we feel about one versus the other, but to come together as a community and as a city to work on this important issue, which is to get rid of illegal guns or guns off the streets of the city. So it's going to take place this Saturday, the Saturday, May 21st, at St. Edith Stein from 10 o'clock in the morning until 2 o'clock in the afternoon. And the reason why we selected the church is to kind of take it away from city government sites. We wanted to take it away from City Hall, take it away from the police department, so that the citizens and the individuals who want to turn in guns have the ability to do it freely without any fear of law enforcement being present, because the intent is to get guns off the streets. That's the bottom line. We try to get the guns off the streets. And frankly, we're not really concerned how those guns got there, as long as they get to us so we can get rid of them. And in the process, those that actually turn in the guns will get a gift certificate to Vicente's supermarket here in the city of Brockton for, I believe it's $200 worth of gift certificates that you're going to get to. So you're basically trading in a gun for some food or for some groceries. And I hope that folks that are watching us at this time, and I hope that this goes on the air before Saturday, that the additional people will see this and talk to their neighbors, talk to their friends, talk to anybody you can talk to. I mean, we all know that there are guns in the streets of Brockton. We all know that. It might not be there's one in my house, actually, but I have a license to carry one. But there are individuals out there who actually are owning guns that have no business owning guns, and it's important for us to talk it out, to see to it that we can share our concerns with our neighbors and friends, and to make sure that this event is successful, not in terms of so we can photo op and post it all over the paper, but the fact that we do get guns off the streets in the city of Brockton, knowing that the summer
is right around the corner. The more we can do to get these guns off, the better off we are as a city. And I hope that you will collaborate and cooperate with us and help us out in this event that's being put together by the mayor's office and the rest of us.
And again, we really owe some gratitude to Moses' initiative on that. And if you are going to turn in a gun, remember when you transport it from your residence to the church, it needs to be in your trunk and it needs to be unloaded. With that being said, in terms of the agenda, again, I said that our superintendent, Kathy Smith, is here. I don't know, Superintendent, if you wanted to give any update, but I do know that people probably have seen throughout the city really wonderful signs, Brockton Kids Count signs. They're scattered about the city, and we can talk about that. But if Dr. Smith wants to elaborate on anything relative to giving an update, we would truly appreciate that. Good evening.
Thank you. As far as an update goes, I want to thank certainly our elected officials from our legislative delegation to our city council and our school committee. And I think in my finishing up my first 3 years, that has been, I think, the strength of what is happening. We have open dialogue. We don't always agree, but we have conversation, and I think decisions, and I thank everybody, are really made in the best interest of our kids. And that's where we'll go. It's interesting about the Brockton Kids Count campaign. I was very frustrated recently when there's an article on the front page talking about the campaign. And what I really want to hear on the front page is this is a way to support our parents. One of the things that we've been trying to do the whole 3 years with our strategic plan is to really empower our parents to be advocates for their children, to talk about what kind of an education they want, how can we best support our students. So when you talk about this campaign, I think it was born out of the fact that we were very frustrated with the state budget that recently came down. But what we're planning to do with this campaign, and thank you to those businesses, we've reached out to a few businesses, we'd love to continue to reach out to businesses, to families, because this is about educating our parents, making sure that they have a voice. I want to see them at the school committee meetings. I want to hear them talking to me about what they want for their children, so we can certainly act in the best interest and do whatever we can to make sure our children are resourced in the best possible way. I just left Brockton High. Tonight is senior awards night. And I have to tell you, it is amazing what these kids do. It's amazing what they accomplish. And many times with some hardships that they face every single day. And you have a wonderful high school. You know, we have our issues. We're a large urban high school. But you will graduate in the next couple of weeks over 900 youngsters that you will see in colleges. They will have careers. They will go into the military. And hopefully, I think we want to build the kind of city where they come back. We talk to them all the time about coming back and being our teachers, bringing up your families. This is a great place to do that. We do have a struggling budget, and just to give you a very quick update, the mayor has funded us at this point to what we call full foundation, and this is in collaboration with the state. Quite a bit of our money comes from the state, and the city does their best to support education. It does have to go before the city council within the next month, so we have a final budget. We're out there advocating with our state legislative delegation to really take a look at some of those things that are impediments to making sure our kids get what we call equity in education. I just went to a superintendent conference today, and the deputy commissioner spoke about the state being strapped for cash, and that is true. You know, we're either in another recession or we're headed for one. These are difficult times. And I thank everybody out there that supports business coming into the city and is really looking for the ways to make sure that we are a place that people want to come educate their children and bring up their families. So I'm certainly open to any questions that you might have. The budget process is still very fluid. We are hopeful that there will be some changes or that we're able to make sure that our children have the same opportunities as the children in West Bridgewater, Easton, Boston, you name it. So that certainly is the goal of this administration. Are there any questions? You're talking schools and the lead. Is that what you're talking? Yeah. There is money that has come from the government. We've certainly applied for, I think it was actually due today, our application. So we're very much on top of it. I'm very pleased, and I think there's one in here. We have the water filtration stations. So what we're doing is we're replacing, and we're doing this all over the system. And we should have it done by the end of the summer. And you should see the kids go to the water filtration system. They come with their bottles. They fill it up. It's really been something that we've been doing for the past couple of years. So we'll continue to do that to make sure our bubblers are updated. But we are very much on top of that. I think Deputy Superintendent Thomas and our facility department that works with our city officials to make sure that the water our children are drinking is appropriate. Yes, they should. They should all be done at the end of the summer, all of the bubblers. Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Superintendent. And again, the superintendent touched upon a couple of things in terms of inequity and funding. As you may recall, and I know Attorney Holmes is here, but you don't need to be a lawyer to know that Brockton in the past has actually filed lawsuits. It was the Webby case. It was followed by the McDuffie case and the Hancock case as well, relative to showing the Commonwealth that the, quote, lower income or poorer communities should get fair funding. And I know collectively all local officials, state officials, are looking and working with Attorney Superintendent Smith to contemplate if we should revisit that. In terms of the budget, and Tim Cruz, our Ward 1 Council, but our City Council President and Chair of the Finance Committee, has designated June 6th, 7th, and 8th to be our City Council budget hearings. Councilor Farwell mentioned we do anticipate to get the books, the budget books, the mayor's budget books in the near future. We don't have them yet, but we will be spending some quality due diligence period time on that to try to vet it out. But, you know, we're not naive to the fact it's going to be very difficult, very, very difficult financial times right now. With that being said, I don't know if we should at this point, unless Mr. Hook or Attorney Nezzarella have any updates that they want to provide, or Shane, if you want to give any updates. But with that being said, we're going to open it up to the Q&A. This is really what the gist of the meeting was. If there's any resident, anybody here at all that has any questions, criticisms, suggestions, please just come to the microphone, because again, this is being recorded live. Good evening, Shane.
How's it going? Not really any questions, just some self-promotion. We're working on our citywide comprehensive plans, going to be called a blueprint for Brockton. We're having some community listening meetings. We're having actually one here. We're doing one on Tuesday, June 14th at North Middle School, Thursday, June 16th at South Middle School, Wednesday, June 22nd at East Middle School, and Thursday, June 23rd at West Middle School. They're all going to be at 7 to 9. Just pretty much going on the rundown, we're going to talk about the planning efforts for citywide, ties into the mayor's Brockton 2025 plan as well. We just want to hear from the public to see what they like about Brockton, what needs to change, what makes their neighborhood special, and what should our citywide comprehensive master plan focus on. So feel free to contact us. We have a website, ablueprintforbrockton.com. We have a Facebook, ablueprintforbrockton.com, a Twitter, planbrockton.com, and also an Instagram, ablueprintforbrockton. So if you have any we're actually going to be actually conducting some of the meetings in English, but we'll have translators there for Cape Verdean Creole, Haitian Creole, and also Spanish. So we'll have different facilitators there gathering around for people that don't speak English. But if you have any questions regarding the citywide comprehensive plan, feel free to contact the planning department or email us. And also, I'm also promoting the final meeting for the Keith Park redevelopment plan. We're going to meet at the fountain. If it rains, we're going to meet at the Lutheran Church. It's going to be at 6 o'clock on June 9th, and all are invited. So we actually have a section on our website dedicated to the redevelopment for Keith Park. And also feel free to contact us via the phone or email. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Shane. Very, very informative information. Thank you for your efforts and Mr. May's efforts in the planning department as well. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, is there any questions for any of the councilors at large, or any statements?
Derek Barrows or something. No?
So I guess what we could talk about then is recently, you might have seen it in the newspaper, but there was some initiatives coming actually from Shane's office and Mr. Rob May relative to the City Council and the Finance Committee vetting out and analyzing revitalization of downtown. It ties into, it's a Massachusetts general law. It's called Chapter 40R Smart Growth Zoning and also 40Q. There's some other initiatives that the City Council has been working on relative to a resolve to try to contemplate reacquiring the Ganley Building. As you know, coming down Route 123 Belmont Street, when you get to Main Street, it's the old Joe Ganley Building right there. And under the former Governor Patrick, city vis-a-vis the City Council, we conveyed it for a dollar to the state, under the pretenses that there would be a college collaborative coming in that exact location. That wasn't funded with the current governor, Charlie Baker. So in my humble opinion, I'm just one of 11. I would like to see us, being the City of Brockton, try to get that back, because we actually was sold some false goods, in my opinion. That college collaborative is not coming in the near future to the City of Brockton with the budget as is. And again, we don't own that building right now. That's an asset that's owned by the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. We have had Mayor Carpenter come before the Finance Committee a couple different times to discuss it. Right now, what we've been told is that it's going to be a very, very expensive proposition relative to razzing that building. That building is not up to code. If you drive by it now, there's the red X's. So if there was a fire there, the fire department wouldn't go in there either. But again, we need to really kind of look at what the options are. We have spoken to our fine city solicitor, Mr. Nezzarella, as well, to see if there's any reversion, meaning have it come back to the City of Brockton due to the fact that the college collaborative, and that's what it was geared to and only earmarked for, is not coming to fruition right now. But there's been other things, and I'll let the councilors that I'm joined with talk about it as well. But you know, the Kresge Building is something Shana can talk about, because again, it's a hot issue. It's something that the City Council is really analyzing right now. Councilor Barnes.
Thank you, Councilor Sullivan. As my colleague said, I have been looking into some of the issues with the Kresge Building, and you know, just to kind of bring you up to speed, if you're not aware, the Kresge Building is located at 121 Main Street. It's right there on the corner of Frederick Douglass Avenue and Main Street. And several years ago, there were some issues with it. The facade started to fall down. I think some people may have even been hurt, passersby. And so there was an effort at that time to remove the facade. And there were communications with several developers and developer companies and the city, the administration at the time, to purchase the building and to convey the building for some sort of mixed use. So to be able to maybe use that little cafe downstairs and then also build several levels above for market rate and some housing and apartments, with the anticipation of the Trinity Project, the Lofts Project, the College Collaborative, all of these things. So in that time, just, you know, real estate and construction, those things take time. And in that time, the building continued to deteriorate. And then when Mr. May came with his department, he worked with the Brockton Main Street Improvement or Investment Club. They're the gentlemen or the people that own the building at this particular time. And they were working very closely with them on going forward with that original plan to have it be a little cafe and housing and things as well. However, we all know just kind of one day it was torn down. The street was blocked off and then it was torn down. I had filed actually a resolve because we did get notice that the building was going to be torn down. And again, I was slightly confused. I can't speak for my colleagues, but I was confused because we were told that this plan was going forward, that there were investors involved, things were going to be happening. We were shown the project and all of the designs, and then it was torn down. So in my investigation, actually, I'm still in the process of doing some investigation, and I've consulted with Councillor Sullivan as well, as he's an attorney and has done real estate work. I'm consulting with him what to do going forward, and I was able to actually contact and have a lengthy discussion with the current owners of that particular property, and I'm going to be bringing them before the council again. So I just want to let all the Brockton residents listening and here know, please be aware of that, because they will be coming. They do have a plan for it, and they're still willing to work with the city, understand understanding kind of all the challenges, even with the College Collaborative not coming, some of those things happening. They still have a very, very cogent plan for that whole area, that whole Frederick Douglass area. And now with the building gone, if you're going north on Main Street, you can really see some of the value that's in on that other side, that 32 High Street side. They have the new windows on top there. So there are a lot of things that actually, you know, the building coming down, that it's exposed, and but they are still very, very interested. And I'm going to go forward with that to make sure that that's going to be another one of the gems of the downtown. And that whole area, that's the foundation of the revitalization of the downtown project, if I'm speaking correctly. That's what Rob May's doing. Restaurant incubators, getting some nightlife or something down there so that Brockton and our downtown doesn't close when the sun goes down. We need to be competitive. We need to make sure that we can do that, and that's going to be the linchpin in that. So I actually took a cue from my colleague and his resolve to get some information about the Ganley building, because I was concerned about that building. And so we definitely will be giving you update on that. So it is very, very, it's still in play. That ball is still in the air, and I'm going to try to volley it as much as I can with the cooperation of my colleagues to make sure that we get that done. There is one more thing, too, I just wanted to say really, really quickly. I know, let's see, last year, the end of the legislative session last year, I'd mentioned my investigation also in looking into the Star Chase program, and I've actually been getting a lot of calls, even from police officers, asking kind of like, hey, what's going on with this project? As anything, and especially with legal parameters and things that you have to clear and check and make sure that, you know, we're not breaking laws and violating civil rights and just tramping all over the Constitution, I've been working very closely with the legal department, Attorney Federoff and the Assistant City Solicitor. She's been working very closely with myself, with the Chief of Police, with the Procurement Officer, and also with the developers of this program. So that has not gone away. We're in the process of working out some things. There are some legal issues because it is a new program to the state of Massachusetts. There are other places that have it, Milwaukee, Texas, all these other places. They have that program. And what it is, it's several of the patrol cars or the fleets, several of the cars in the fleet, they would be outfitted with like a little homing beacon that if they stop a car and someone gets antsy or in the police officer's professional opinion, someone looks like they're going to run off, they can deploy that onto the back of the car, and instead of chasing them through the street and going 90 miles an hour, tan them out to kind of these people with these illegal guns with no training running off in the street. So, and what it does, it sends out a GPS signal to the rest of the department so that they can radio, you know, Officer Jones up the street that a black sedan is, you know, coming your way, suspected of blah, 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 whatever. So instead of having to chase them down, and we've had several chases, actually there was one in the paper just the other day, and the one that really was of concern to me was the one that went up on the highway through Randolph and came back through Avon. That could have ended up so much worse than it did. And thank God, you know, our police and surrounding areas, public safety officials, that they were able to keep that as with least amount of damage as possible. But that is something that we're still working on, and I'm going to diligently work on it. The police chief, he's on board. The mayor's on board. So we're just working out the legal issues on that. So I definitely want to do that. Also, one more thing, if you don't mind. Oh, I got so many things going on. I'm so excited. I also mentioned, too, about the dog park. In a city like Brockton, we have a lot of dog owners. And some people were saying, like, oh, you know, that's such a little thing. It actually isn't. And the way I looked at it, I mean, as a dog owner, I also looked at it as a place where the community can come and you can get to know someone you may not otherwise get a chance to meet. Maybe you stay, you know, in your area, stay in your neighborhood. You go to the dog park, you meet someone with the same kind of dog, or you have something immediately in common. And again, with anything, the legalities of that. You know, we don't want the city liable for somebody getting mauled or, you know, somebody getting bitten or some situation of that nature. So we're working with that as well. And I'm also working with the city solicitor's office on that as well. And we've actually overcome one legal hump on that and working with that. And we've actually, I've actually convened a neighborhood park association. And we're kind of still toying with the name, Friends of the Brockton Dog Park. But there was also a suggestion for the name of the park. I don't know if some of you remember K9 Gomo. Mm-hmm. That's what we're leaning very, very strongly to naming the dog park Canine Gomo. And his handler, Officer Davin Anderson, he was on board with that. And we think that would be an excellent tribute to Gomo and all that he has done. And but we're looking at that. So we have an association we've been meeting, working with legal. We're working on getting the right location. And you know, if all goes well and we get funding, there's grant funding available. We're hoping to really have that be another community gem in Brockton that we can, you know, definitely advertise and put out there. So that's pretty much my update for what's going on. And any questions about anything I've said? Yes, ma'am. Yeah. There was something with that. Someone had come. Maybe Councillor Ianneri might know that better. But I remember the building department. They came to the council. And we did ask about that. Like, what's going on with it? And it's in such poor condition. I guess from what I understand, there's no roof, so all of the elements, snow, rain, everything we've ever had happen since the burning of the building. It's just completely destroyed, you know, that entire building. So I think we have to find the right investors, and I'm sure that that's definitely on the agenda also too for the planning department and what to do with that particular building to see, you know, if it can be saved or if it can go someplace. But I'm sure that it's on the radar.
Okay, and if you have a dog park, what about a cat park? We have a licensed dog, but cats
right.
Don't have to.
You know what? That's actually funny because a person who's on the association, she'd mentioned something about a cat park in Arizona or something like that, Tucson. Apparently, having a cat park is just like herding kittens. It's very, very difficult, and they run off. And you know, those are things that we would have to worry about, things like that, liability. I mean, if a cat runs off and, you know, gets run over, God forbid, that's horrible. And It's a little harder to maintain a cat park, but because my perspective is dogs. I have two dogs, so, and that's kind of like one of my passions, one of the loves I have. I'm gonna work on this one first. But we can talk going forward, see if we can maybe herd those kittens in.
And thank you. You were at the North Junior High as well, so thank you for being here. And we recognize that first of all, we wanted this place packed, right? I mean, that the goal is to have this place filled to the gills, standing room only. And you know, I think we have to kind of iron out some more wrinkles. I think publicity and PR wise, we need to improve that. I do know that we, you know, the third one will be in September. We won't do it in the summer because we'll have maybe two people here. But we'll do it in September, and then I would think, you know, in conjunction with my colleagues, we would do one in November, and that would be four for this year. But I do recognize, and I think I can speak for my three colleagues as well, that we will continue to do that. It's kind of at the infancy stage, but the gist is to be able to articulate to you updates. I think Councilor Farwell summed it up. I mean, there's 11 of us on the council, four of us are at large. We don't always agree, but we try to work in collaboration to better the city of Brockton where we live. I mean, Shayna Bond, she's a key advisor to Congressman Lynch, you know, our congressman. Moses Rodriguez was a key advisor under Jim Harrington when he was mayor. You know, Councilor Fowler is a former mayor, school committee member, cop. I mean, there's some skill sets in the city council, I think, that are really, really helpful. But there's only one person on the city council that's the dean, and that would be the Ward 3 councillor. And so with that being said, I'm going to have Mr. Yaneri come up and give us an update.
I've always been known to spark a little bit of interest when I speak, so I might as well. But anyhow, I want to commend my Fort Lodge representatives for coming out and doing this, as Councillor Sullivan said. And they've selected their dates for this year. And, you know, it was under Councillor Sullivan's presidency just a year and a half, 2 years ago, that we also had joint meetings between the city council, the school committee, the mayor. We even met here, I believe it was one of the locations, as well as we went to the other middle schools, and was received very well. The problem we had, believe it or not, was trying to get all of us in the same room together between all of the elected officials. It did work, and I tried as council president to do the same thing, but for whatever reason, it broke down a little bit when I had discussions with the mayor and other school committee members and city councils, and it didn't really go through last year. So that I'll take the blame to that, to the hit of that, but I think it's a great idea when we all do come out and address the public. And as everybody knows, I've been council here in Ward 3 for 13 years, and out of my 13 years, I've held ward meetings at least three or four times out of the course of a year. I hold them here sometimes. Majority of my ward meetings are held at the Kennedy School, very well attended. Nice to see attendance here as well, because that shows the interest you have in the city. So I think that's a great plus, and again, I commend them for coming out. Believe it or not, some people don't realize what our schedule is, and I left work early tonight because I had to go to the License Commission, and I'll tell you why I was at the License Commission, because starting at the end of this month, the Rock Stadium is going to start to have some concerts, and I have great concern when we have concerts at the stadium. I realize that we're trying to raise revenue between, you know, the city and what we're trying to do at the Rock Stadium. We're trying to bring in some revenue, but my greatest concern was the fact that when I saw the time for it to start on Sunday, May the 29th at 4 in the afternoon and not end until 1 o'clock the next day, 1 o'clock in the morning, I should say, it didn't win any votes with me. So I was there, and Councillor Cruz, the president of the council, was there as well, and we made a compromise that it's going to end earlier. Everything will conclude at 11 o'clock, and they have to be out of there vacated by midnight. They're going to have their security, because they have a security company that works there. Naturally now, because that particular the concerts being held over at the stadium and not the fairgrounds, it definitely made some concern to parking, and actually they'd be parking in Brockton High School. Naturally, that's a lot that they use. So there's going to be extra police force there as well, and Lieutenant LeGrice said that he's taking that under his helm. So I feel confident, but it's going to be the real test. It's going to be a big test because, as I've said, Campanelli Stadium is in a neighborhood, and I take in that neighborhood of those streets that once you go up Forest Avenue and you're headed east and you get on Gordon Street, then you come to Ash Street, you come to Brea Circle, Highland Terrace, you come to all the neighborhood streets that I have, and I don't want to be up at 3 o'clock in the morning answering the phone. I really don't. I'm getting older. I need a little bit of sleep at night, but that's part of our job, so I have to do what I have to do. So just to let you know that, and that's going to happen on, again, May 29th, and it's going to be at the Rock Stadium. Just to give you a couple of highlights of just a few things happening here in my ward, and as you look out and you see I have a situation across the way here where I have some heavy equipment. A gentleman had a business right across the way there, had every right to have his business there because it's a commercial residential zoned area. I was able to go to the zoning meeting with he and some of my colleagues at large were there and helped me along the way as well, so that we can hopefully start to, at some point before the fall, we're going to construct some homes there. Three lots I've given an okay to, zoning board has agreed to. We've got to go to the planning board, and at that point in time, Leech Ave will be produced a little bit, and we're going to make a nice little neighborhood because I can't have that type of situation there any longer. It's been long overdue. Situation that was is when the person wanted to replace the roof. Unfortunately, when he started to, the building started to come down at the same time. It was believe it or not, it was an old Studebaker garage, and I don't know, Councillor Fowle might remember that more so than me. No, I know, everyone looks at you and we talk about old, right?
You think
I'm saying Model T. Model T, there you go. But in any case, that's what's going to be happening across the way, and I think that's going to be a big, big plus. And as you know, this here is a South Middle School, and I tell you, for the age that it is, when you go through this school, you'll be ever so amazed, as you are in all our schools. The cleanliness of this school building is just, it's just unbelievable. They do a wonderful, wonderful job here. The students are happy here. There's never really any concerns here. You go across the way, you have the Huntington School. Today they had a great day. It was the annual Huntington School Parade. I was unfortunately wasn't able to make it because of my work schedule, but two nice things that you have happening right here within this neighborhood. And it's an older neighborhood, but it's a great neighborhood. And it's the same way throughout the city of Brockton. You have some tremendous spots still here in the city. And I don't want to keep going on to talk, but I think the greatest concern that we have as councilors is what we're going to be doing in the next few weeks when we see the mayor's budget. And I want everybody to remember that that is the mayor's budget that comes before us. And I know Councillor Farrell can attest to that because he served as a mayor for 4 years. And he presents the budget, he brings it to the council, and then we have to do our due diligence to how we now make sure that the revenue is there so that we continue to work in the best interest of the people of the city. Naturally, our school system is most at most in to my heart, as is to all my colleagues. And again, I had many years as a school committee member, so I'm very strong-hearted when it comes to education, because I firmly believe that that's what we, you know, that's what the city is all about. That's what it's built about. So just to let you know the few of the things that are, you know, happening within. But it's not going to be an easy year. It's not. So I hope that we can get through everything. And I'm sure we will. I'm sure we will and do the best that we can. So with that being said, I appreciate it. And thank you, councilors, for allowing me to have a couple words. Thank you.
We really enjoy serving with Dennis. I mean, he has a skill set as well. He served many, many years on the school committee as well. So we do thank him. And in terms of that, I mean, that business owner is not leaving the city of Brockton, M&M Construction, which is a good thing, staying here in the city of Champions. But really, that's going to bring the neighborhood context in place with three brand new houses over there. So we do want to thank the Ward 3 Council for his efforts on that. And it also will help the tax base as well for some residential houses over there. I also would like to have an update from an initiative that at Wynn Farwell is doing, something that I did last legislative session, and Wynn's running with it, and I've signed on to it as well. And just yesterday, I got a call from our former state rep and also City Councilor Jerry Creedon, who's a resident of West Elm Street, and Mrs. Palladino, very, very upset about litter and blight. And that's not just unique to West Elm Street. That's throughout the city of Brockton. We need to get a handle on that with code enforcement. So kudos to Mr. Farwell. He has filed the resolve, and I'm going to let Wynn give an update on that as well. Thank you.
This will be very quick, but it actually dovetails into the urban renewal plan. I want everyone to know that we will still be very much focused on neighborhoods. Yes, we're going to concentrate some efforts down into the downtown area to revitalize the downtown area, increase the density of the housing. But in the neighborhoods and in the streets that lead downtown, we don't want junk cars. We don't want apartments that have been put into houses illegally because they could be a fire hazard. We don't want to issue garage licenses with a restriction on 10 cars and then find out somebody has 30 cars. So Bob and I have filed a resolve which will bring all of the code enforcement people together and the mayor, and we want to work with everyone to say, okay, look, we've got these ordinances, we have these state laws, let's make sure that on a proactive way we go out and first educate people. I'm not for dropping the hammer on someone the first time. I think it's very important that you educate people as to what's expected of them if they have a particular type of license or run a particular type of business, and let them get up to speed, let them understand what their requirements are. But then after a period of time, hold them accountable and say, look, you know, you've got to come into compliance, and then have the various entities that are involved, the building department, the license commission, police department, fire department, go out and enforce those ordinances and laws, because that is a part of public safety. Just as what Bill Healy does and all of the members of the police department, code enforcement is part of public safety. So we think working in a collaborative effort with the mayor and the department heads, the license commission and others, will be able to have a concerted effort and be proactive rather than reactive. What I don't want to have is have a fire occur and then we react and we go out to a business and find out that they had too many vehicles, something caught fire, and now we've had a major issue to deal with. So that's what we hope to do. The other boring thing I will say about the budget, which Councillor Ian Erie mentioned, the one thing to remember, and those of you who went to North Junior High heard me say this, it is the mayor's budget. We can only approve as presented or we can reduce an appropriation, but we cannot add to an appropriation, and we can't move money around. We can't say, well, gee, I'd like $50,000 more to go to the school department as opposed to the police department, or something of that nature. So it's very important to know our limitations. And that's why we go through it with great diligence, so that we're sure that the money is allocated where it should be. I know the mayor works very hard on this for many months with the department heads and the chief financial officer, and we'll look forward to getting that book. And after all, as I always say, which is humorous, but it's true, it's your money. It's our money, because we pay taxes too. And I want to make sure our money is spent wisely and where it's needed. So thank you very much, Councilor Sullivan.
Thank you, Councilor. With that being said, it looks like we have Mr. Ford and Mr. Hersey that would like to speak. So the mic's yours, Bob.
Hi, how are you? I share the same sentiments. I'd like to see a full hall here, but unfortunately it didn't happen tonight. But basically, I wanted to talk about the mayor's budget. I put that in quotation marks. We all know who the architect of that budget is. But every year, he'll get up and preach dire straits and the city ready for collapse, and he'll demand the full 2.5%, and he'll hit the two panic buttons, safety and education, you know, as projected cuts if we don't toe the mark as far as approving the budget. But nothing in the administrative end at all. That's where all the plum political patronage jobs are. It's really strange. You have a city that has no qualms about dumping $7 million a year into that money pit down in Dighton. A prominent Boston attorney has looked at that and said we should have walked away from this damn thing years ago, but we're still shelling out $6.5 million, almost $7 million a year down there. I mean, that money could do a lot of good for the city. And another thing too is that some well-connected folks have got massive tax abatements. I mean, God help the average person who tries to go down and get a few bucks knocked off his taxes. You know, they tell them to do all this research. Like, I live in a small raised ranch. My taxes went up $155 a quarter. And I actually did the homework. I hit four or five other raised ranches, and they're all in the same boat. They all went up. But Bernie Hassan there was there giving us advice on how to go about it. And he was talking about apples to apples and oranges to oranges. And you wonder what kind of fruit that these folks use to get these abatements. But, that's basically, hopefully you'll get a better turnout in June when the tax hearing starts. You know, that's probably the biggest problem with the city is public apathy. Nobody seems to give a damn. You got a 15% turnout in a mayoral election. It's sad. But, all right, that's all I have to say.
No, and we, if you don't know Bob Ford, Bob is really someone that's a caring person. He comes to a lot of the meetings. And I thank you for your insights and your opinions.
Yeah, I just have one other thing to add, Bob. A few years ago during the water debacle, the city had no qualms about shelling out $100,000 to have an audit done. And basically they came back and told us what we already knew, that there was a massive failure of the meter system, a failure in the upper management level. But yet you talk about having the city's finances audited, and right away, no, that's a sacred cow. You can't do that. Let's open up the books and see how much the city has.
One thing that I think at least I'm going to try to do, and I would hope my city council colleagues buy into it, and it's stealing an idea from we're the city of champions, but this is the city of presidents. In Quincy, their city council has a lawyer. Our city council has a lawyer, but their city council has their own private auditor. It's part of an ordinance, and I think the city of Brockton on the city council legislative side should really look into that as well, because again, we're given a budget, and there's nobody on the city council that I'm aware of that's a CPA or an accountant, and I think it'd be very important to consider the cost estimate of what it would be and what it would really realize.
Yeah. Well, another thing too, the city is not as broke as it claims to be. And look at the bond rating the city has. You don't get a bond rating like that unless you have the finances to back it. All right.
Thank you, Mr. Ford. Right. June 6th, 7th, 8th, we'll see you at the budget. All right. Mr. Hersey, good evening.
Good evening, and thank you for having us. first, I want to say, when you do look at the budgets, please remember the police department is 28 officers short, the fire department is 28 or 29 short, and the school department cannot afford to lose any more teachers. Now, I'm saying that because I am a high school teacher, but it's just crazy to keep laying off teachers. Students should have a 23-24-1 to ratio. What are we up to now? 28-29-1, Mr. Smith? Yeah, that's unfair. Okay, so please keep that in mind when you're doing the budgets. Now, I'm not here tonight to talk about specifically that, but our police and fire department and our school department are second to none in the country. I also think that what you ought to look at is four-year terms for city councilors and mayor with a two-term limit, because I don't think you can do the job in 2 years. I really don't, and I think that needs to be changed. But I'm here tonight to tell you that for 5 years in a row, our taxes got increased. And then on the sixth year, our homes values got increased on the abatements. And now, also, our water rates went up. When's it going to stop? When's it going to stop? We can't afford this. Okay? Now, let me say this to you, too. I'm here basically to talk about Century 21 and the Brockton Rocks. Everybody knows it's a losing proposition. That baseball team cannot put people in the stadium, a college baseball team. We're losing money every year. Every year we're losing money up there like crazy. Yet they're getting free water. They're getting free electricity. They're getting their rent cut in two. Gosh, I think all the taxpayers here would like to get free water and free electricity too. All right? So you've got to realize that something's got to be done with that stadium. Now, I just heard for the first time we're having concerts up there. I hope the city isn't funding that, but the owner is funding that. So I have to ask you, Mr. Rini, who is funding the concerts?
They are.
That's great, okay? Because we needed some creativity up there, because that stadium just sits there and sits there and sits there and loses money like crazy. It's a losing proposition. And we really have to think, if we're going to continue baseball there, to get a legitimate minor league baseball team in there, which will draw. A college baseball team will not draw. Plus, that college baseball team that's up there in that league they're in are Division III players. They're non-scholarship. All the Division I scholarship players are down on Cape Cod, and that's what people go and watch them, because they're the prospects for the pros. And that's what basically happens. So we've really got to look at, and I'm very disappointed to hear, that we've just given the Rocks an extended five-year contract. When are we going to learn about these long-term contracts? They don't work. No contract should be for more than 3-4 years at a time, all right? I mean, but you do have to give people 3 years to show what they can do and what they can't do. So please keep that in mind. But I'm going to finish off by saying this. Don't cut our police and fire department and our school department short on the budgets that are coming up. Thank you.
No, I think I've spoken with you by phone, but I had not met you, Dennis, so now I can put the face with the name. I think most of you know we have been quite vocal and focused on the whole issue of the Rock Stadium, Campanelli Stadium, and the Conference Center and Brockton 21st Century Corporation, and it's too lengthy to go into tonight. I will say that the council did pass an order rescinding an earlier order which placed the 21st Century Corporation in exclusive control of the stadium and the conference center. Now anything that's done up there will have to come back before the council for approval. We can't go back and undo what's been done, but we're very conscious of the fact that that is a city asset. I think someday it can be very valuable to the city. I'm not convinced we're getting what we should in terms of revenue coming back to us that we are, but I can't go back and undo what's been done, so we have to go forward. And the issue of revenues for the city, we are so heavily dependent on state aid, not only educational aid, but unrestricted general government aid, that's why the urban revitalization plan became important. Initially, I voted not to favorably recommend it because I hadn't heard from the chief financial officer, and I thought the mayor should come forward and say that he was fully in favor of it. Now we have all gotten on board. I want it to be successful. To the extent that we increase the tax base, we increase revenues coming in, and we take care of the schools and the police and fire departments, because there's one thing that Superintendent Smith and Councillor Iannarri and I know, and I'm sure the other councillors do, how successful your school system is has a direct bearing on your property values. People move to a city because they know that we have an exceptional school system. You probably saw in the paper recently, we had a young man accepted to, I think, 6 out of 7 Ivy League colleges. 7 out of 8? I couldn't even get into Duke University, but that was my fault. But I don't shortchange Northeastern or BU. So, but you know, that tells you a lot. And I've always said this, and I'm glad that this is being broadcast. The one important ingredient over and above revenues and over and above a quality teaching staff is parent involvement. That's the other key that we always have to emphasize, because the learning doesn't stop at 2:30 when you get out of school. It continues when you get home and someone says, what work have you got tonight? TV doesn't go on until you get that assignment done. And so if we all work on funding, and we still maintain exceptional staff, and we continue with parent involvement, we're going to have a very successful city. And that's also true of Crime Watch. You could put 1,000 cops out on the street. If the public doesn't get along with the police and they don't cooperate, you're not going to get anything done. And so that's why the work of Officer Healy and the other officers who interact with the citizens become so important. It's not just about money. It is to a certain extent, but there is so much more, and that's what we've all been working on. We heard a report just the other night on how we may be able to enhance police-community relations. So there's a lot going on, and without taking up any more time, I'm just glad that we collaborate, and I'm just glad that when we have a meeting, we have Councillor Iannarri here, and sometimes other councillors come in, because we realize it takes a team. I mean, one of us doesn't make any difference at all. It's you have to have the team in place, so.
And one more thing, just Mr. Hersey had mentioned maybe trying to get a minor league affiliate at the Rock Stadium. I talked to Major League Baseball about 4 years ago, and believe it or not, because what I looked at was the city of Lowell, the Lowell Spinners as the affiliate for the Sox. And what I was told is that the city of Brockton is too close to Pawtucket, geographic-wise, so we're barred from having an affiliate in the city of Brockton because Major League Baseball has these rules and regulations. So right now we can't bring an affiliate to Brockton with Major League Baseball. And the Northern League, that was the original Rocks, and it was owned by that guy Bill Veeck and Bill Murray, the actor. I mean, that's gone kaput. So I concur with you, Dennis. I mean, the good baseball players, Division I, they all go to the Cape for the summer. But we do need to look at that asset and try to realize the great potential that it has. So thank you. Attorney Holmes.
So a couple of things. I'll just go right down the line. Shayna, thank you for looking into the 121. You know, the proponent and that company presented a glorious plan on December 1st at West Junior High with beautiful pictures and promises. And it really, it misled a lot of people, and there's people that, you know, accepted that as being real. And, I mean, I hope it still is real, but right now it doesn't feel real. It feels as though, you know, something has gone awry here. And, you know, when the Kresge building was first being torn down, there were actually people who were like, oh, no, it's they were actually putting the pictures from the December 1st presentation as if that was going to happen in the immediacy. So, thank you for doing that. I just want to comment on that and say, please, push forward. You need help. You know where I am.
It will develop further.
All right.
It's not just a dream.
Okay. All right. Councillor Sullivan, please keep hard and fast on that Ganley building. You know, we need to get that building back. Whether it has a consequence that we have to pay a bill, that's fine. But I sincerely doubt. I think there was one comment that was made, well, we'll let the state take care of it and take it down, and then we'll get it back from them. That is ludicrous, with all due respect. Nobody tears down a building for you and then says, oh, we paid X million dollars to tear it down, and oh, here's it back. It's not going to happen. So I do encourage you. It's our building. It's our city to either bear the brunt of, to deal with the problem, to take the hit for it, but also to be able to make it to what we want it to be if it's not coming. Councillor Farwell, thank you very much for being on the council. I do have one question or comment. You ran a program at the Arnone School when the abatements were out. I know Moses was also there. The room was packed with people who were struggling and were victims to what I say was, you know, inaccurate abatements. I know that the city did actually do something this year. They actually did go out. They looked at houses. They have given people abatements. And I applaud them for that. I think your involvement in it was part of it. You know, but I do see that also they're doing a reevaluation, and I don't know if you have any information about that, but if you don't, I would ask you to please look into what this reevaluation is that they're doing, and what does it mean, and what is it going to mean for us down the road, because it's on the city website, and it's just sort of plopped there that it's happening, and they talked about people coming out to neighborhoods, but I haven't heard or seen any of that. If they're going out to neighborhoods and doing the true evaluations that they're doing, I thank them for that because that's what I asked for at the Arnone School and I've been asking for the last 10 years. But thank you for running that meeting, and I hope that the people that couldn't make this meeting but were at that meeting are aware that that is going on and to keep in touch with it and to keep on it, and our taxes will be coming out again, and every year they can file that abatement process. So thank you on that. And Moses, just thank you for being our the conscience of our minority in the city. You know, we have a huge minority population. We are a majority minority population, and we really need to you know, bind on that and really promote that. I know we can do it, but thank you very much for when I go to the meetings, you're there, you're asking the questions that relate to what minorities are experiencing, and you were great, and you were there that night at the Arnone School when the majority of the people that were sitting there that really were feeling the crunch, feeling the pinch of that of the taxes that they and the tax bills that they got, that they just couldn't really afford to do. The majority of those individuals were minorities there, and they needed the support, they needed the help. I think that they got it to some extent, and so thank you.
And we'll make sure that if we get an update on the reevaluation process, we'll share it as quickly as we can.
Thank you, Attorney. Glenna. Yeah, you bring up two good points. I know Janice Fitzgerald, who is the Council on Aging Executive Director. She does have a program, but we will convey your suggestions to her as well. In terms of the sand, I remember it growing up in Brockton. It was the Highway Department that would put them around the city. We can talk to the DPW Commissioner Larry Rowley. We have a little bit of time, hopefully, till next winter. But it's really a good point. So thank you for that as well. Yeah, one thing on that, I mean, with the acquisition of the streetlights, I mean, the city of Brockton saved, you know, $600,000 year one, and it kept going, and it's reoccurring savings. But there was a little bit of lag, and they've really worked on that. So, you know, it's 2 or 3 days from when you report it to when it's being done. So thank you for bringing that to our attention. I do want to recognize Ward 5 Councilor Ann Beauregard for joining us tonight as well. Ann, thank you for being here. Councilor, I don't know if you have any comments or anything you want to talk about. Sure.
Okay. Yes, I just want to announce that my Ward 5 meeting is going to be next Wednesday, May 25th, okay, from 6:30 to 8:30 at Caffrey Towers. And the speakers are going to be Steve Hook from BEMA, preparing us for the hurricane season. Corwin Capiello will be coming by to let people know about where kids can go for the summer months, activities, et cetera, Brockton After Dark. Someone will be representing the Board of Health to address the, you know, let people know about the mosquito situation, et cetera. And also, Janice Fitzgerald will be there to talk about services the Council on Aging provides, okay? And any of the other councilors and school committee members are invited, but I'd like to make them information sent. Sessions, and it's at Caffrey Towers, 6:30 to 8:30 on next Wednesday, May 25th. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor.
Thank you. One more thing. I just want to say to Officer Healy, thank you so much for you know, the good job he's doing. And I would like to say that we're trying very hard to get it back. It was at a peak, and then it's like slushed off a little bit. We're really trying to get it going again because it's important. Crime Watch is just a very, very important aspect of what we need. So I thank you.
Thanks, Glenn.
Can I just say something really quickly to Councillor Beauregard? I meant to talk to you today, actually. I wasn't sure what the condition of Caffrey Tower and their phone service was. It was exposed in the paper that with the whole Verizon dust up, yeah, that a lot of the residents had no phone service. But I actually got a contact today. I called Verizon, and I'm going to work with you. And if they don't get that done in a timely fashion, they're going to bring someone out at least to address the people in there to let them know why they have not had phone service. Not everybody in there has a cell phone, so they're virtually stuck in there. And they're stranded. So and I don't know if I'll have an update by next week, but I do want to work with you on that, and we can continue.
Is there anybody else that, Officer, do you have something?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, good. Please.
You ready?
Yeah.
So could you update us and the viewing audience about what Glenna just touched on, the street lighting before you and I get bombarded? I know we're converting to LEDs. I know that we own the lights. But what I'm noticing is lights on in the daytime, off at night. And on top of that, in various locations, and on top of that, I heard a rumor that West Elm Street's going to be the showcase for LEDs. They're going to do that entire street so people get to see exactly what it looks like. There's a place, friends of mine that have a place down the Cape, the whole town of Dennis is all LEDs. Any updates on, like, as you said, they do come and they'll fix the lights. We know that. But they're deteriorating, and I wonder if it's because they're waiting for the big conversion.
So a couple of things. So when Brockton bought every streetlight in the city of Brockton from National Grid, it cost us $48,000, and we own every streetlight, not the pole, but the actual, they call it the Cobra light. And again, it's been millions of dollars savings since we acquired, and it's going to continue to be. That was phase one. You know, the city council and I drafted it. We filed a resolve to have Mr. Carpenter, the mayor, come before us to look at phase two for the LED relative to using it actually as a crime deterrent, because you can heighten the light in crime-ridden areas and you can density. It's also a 10-year warranty, so you buy it, that bulb's going to be there for 10 years. The mayor came before us. He said that he's working on it. To my knowledge, I don't know if any of the councilors can correct me, I don't believe there has been phase two LED lights within the city of Brockton put in that the council's been made aware of yet. We were told from the mayor that they're looking at it, they're looking at different companies. There's going to be a pretty good upfront expense to acquire it, so we're going to probably have to bond it out, do a municipal bond and amortize it over some terms. So I can't report back to you on that, Bill, other than to my knowledge, and I don't think Moses or Dennis or Wynn or Shana would say anything differently, we don't believe that it's been done yet. That's not what's been told. But again, on West Elm Street, we will definitely look into that.
It hasn't been done yet, just so that we understand. It's something that as they construct that street, the talk was they wanted to do it so that the public can see what it actually looks like, which would be a great idea.
Yeah.
It's just that if they're going to do that and not get the rest of the LEDs until that street's complete, and that's what I was asking, if you knew of a time frame.
When the mayor came before us, he said that he was looking at a couple different companies.
Okay.
To try to figure out. Mr. Connell, the CFO, also was looking at different bonding apparatus relative to that phase two.
And
because the public's going to like it. And if you go down to City Hall, that's what it looks like. It will be a good thing. Right. Just wondering when.
The City Hall is kind of, in how I understood it, the City Hall lights, the way they are, that was one of the blueprints that they were using, because the way it's illuminated, they can change that. And even that little piece, and finding out what color LED to use in certain areas and how to highlight it. And the way the City Hall is now looks at night, it looks really nice. And it looks like daytime kind of at night. So they're working on those things too. And that all comes with as they employ that whole process.
Before this next gentleman speaks, I'm going to embarrass him a little bit and tell you that I've known City Solicitor Phil Nesralla for 30 years, and before that I knew his father, and he's one of the people that kind of works behind the scenes, represents the city in a number of different areas, saves us a ton of money because there are some attorneys, if you had to hire outside counsel, would probably charge us anywhere from $300 to $500 an hour. I've collaborated with Phil and his staff on some ordinances and a couple of orders, resolves that have come before the council. So I'd just like to thank him for always being cooperative, always returning a phone call, and always providing the information that I've needed to function as a counselor. So I just wanted to publicly say that.
Thank you, and it's a pleasure and an honor to work for the City of Brockton. And it's also an honor to become aware that between $300 and $500 an hour, I'll be speaking with you tomorrow. My participation here was first to thank the council members here for participating with the public. I think it's an invaluable mechanism for everybody for us as city officials to learn the public sentiment, and for the public perhaps to get some tidbits as to what the mindset and the mechanics of government are. My presence here was to offer any insight I could on a topic that would be brought up. And actually, Councillor Barnes brought up a topic that I wanted to comment on. Quite frankly, she was talking so fast and covered so much, I forgot what I was going to talk about. But in particular, it was the 121 Main Street, and I know that we will be, or I will be perhaps in front of you at a later time, the full council, with a more detailed timeline. But I just would like to offer for those who may be listening, when the owners of that property purchased it in June of 2013, they took it from tax taking, and they did have elaborate plans and an outline as how they wanted to develop what many Brocktonians realized was a very cherished, well-known area on Main Street. And we had hopes that it would be another focal point on the Main Street property. Approximately 6 months after the ownership was placed in the hands of the new owners, the building department had noticed some the integrity of the building being challenged. There was some chipping and pieces that fell, one brick here and there. So the building department kept an eye on that property, and as time went on, so did the integrity become more challenged. During the interim, the owners were called in. They were asked where they were with these plans. They wanted to get things moving. The building department on their own took it upon themselves to have staging surrounding that building so it would protect the public. We were told financing was coming, and it didn't come in a time frame that we had expected. To make a long story short, and as I stated, it will be more detailed later, there was a point in time subsequent to a board of survey taken that orders were given to take down that building because we were concerned with its safety and its structural integrity. As it became more challenged, the building department was quite concerned over a collapse of the building, which would have caused a disaster. Everyone knows the busy intersection. And after a meeting with the mayor and the building inspector, the order was issued that the building be taken down, and it was taken down immediately for the purpose of protecting the public. Again, at a later point in time, I'll be more than pleased to go through all the detail and unveil all the information we had privy to that helped us arrive at that decision.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Attorney Nesralla. And again, for those that don't know, I mean, Phil has, Attorney Nesralla has served under a couple different mayors, and his office is always, as Wynn said, always ready, willing, and able to answer any counselor's questions or inquiries from a legal component. So thank you for being here as well. If there is any other questions, please come forward. We're getting close to the conclusion. Mr. Hersey, follow up.
wanted to bring up one other point, and I hope somebody does some investigating about this. Brockton has four geisha wells. There's one up on Cary Hill. Inside the old Kresge building, where it was just torn down at the basement there, there's another one. That was used in an emergency situation after the 1938 hurricane to give water to people. There's another one where the old guarded hospital used to be on the ground. Where Ellen B. Keith Field is, that was once upon a time the city pond. We had a swimming pool there. Before Ellen B. Keith Field was built, that was a city swimming pool. All right? There's a big geisha well there. There's another one on the south side between Brookside Ave and Haywood Street. Okay? There's two ponds down there that just keep spurting water all the time. We have four places that we haven't tapped water yet, all right, to find out. And we have through the years, tapped the and tested the water at Cary Hill and on Haywood Street, okay? I know that Kresge's building, the geisha well, many years ago was tapped. It was pure. It was okay drinking water. Okay? The guarded hospital used to use the water in the basement, okay? They had their well there from the old the three streams that met, okay, which used to feed the pond there. But we have four wells that we ought to really look at because we're spending a lot of money on a desal plant that we don't even use. And we all know that that desal plant isn't worth more than $25 million at the very, very most. So we should look into that on these four geisha wells. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Hersey. I hadn't heard that before. So you had. So thank you.
Hi.
Please.
Good evening.
Good evening. My name is Gwen Barnes, a.k.a. Shana's mom, a.k.a. Jane Q. Citizen. I just want to try to end the meeting. I know you're getting ready to do that on a high note of thanks, because I remember about 2 years ago you had, I guess this is a town meeting or a community meeting at the West Middle School regarding the streets and the update for that. And West Elm Street was discussed. And I left there feeling that it would never, ever come to fruition. First of all, they raised my taxes, so I'm glad I'm seeing the fruition of my taxes going up. But I just want to commend, I don't know whether to thank the council people here or whoever, but I'm just grateful that the street, especially West Elm Street, is going to be a showcase or showplace kind of street. It already is. I live on Winifred Road. Before they started working on it, it was awful. Everybody knew that. Potholes everywhere, especially after the dreadful winter we had. And my car is thoroughly out of commission, just shakes all the time. So I just want to say that I'm glad that that has come to some kind of fruition, because I honestly thought it would never be done. I know my daughter kept telling me, we're working on it, they're going to do this, that, and the other, but it's really way beyond wildly, way beyond what I expect. So, and they're talking about the LED lights or LCD lights or whatever kind of lights. It can even be more beautiful. So I don't know who gets the thanks, but I just want to say thank you. Someone must have put a fire under somebody to get it done. I want to end on a high note because I live there and I'm very concerned about my community and my area, and I'm just very grateful. Also, the gentleman who's a teacher, I'm a retired teacher from the Boston Public Schools. I've been teaching longer than my daughter has been living. So I just want to say, seriously, it's true. I just want to say, you know, I'm with you. I hear you. With the class sizes, I think I got out. I'm 10 years retired. I think I got out before it got to 29 plus. So I just wish you well, because I'm very sympathetic to all that the teachers go through, and I hope everything works out. I know they always give out pink slips in June, and hopefully they rehire them back in September. I've gotten a few in my day, but I always knew I'd be rehired. So I just want to say that, and don't lose heart. Don't faint. Because it'll happen. All right, thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Barnes. And before we conclude, I first of all, I want to thank my colleagues. I want to thank Wynn and Shana and Moses, because when I mentioned this to them, they jumped on it, and it's the right thing to do. I want to thank Kathy Smith, Superintendent Smith. I want to thank her Assistant Superintendent Mike Thomas, and really the staff and the custodial services here who set up this room. We really appreciate that. Ward 3 Councillor Dennis Ianeri, Ward 5 Councillor Ian Beauregard. And I, of course, want to thank Emily Reynolds from The Spark, who really has a great business going on. And thank you for doing this live. And also, Brockton Community community access. It's really our hope that in September, when we have our third citywide at-large meeting, it's either going to be at West or East. We hope to have the place packed. So let's spread the word. Let's get it out. And again, thank you for being here tonight. I want to thank my colleagues, and have a good evening. Thank you.